Here we are. So thank you first of all for being here and attending this 30 minutes class, master class about the big trends in wine markets nowadays. Well, I start by briefly introducing myself. I'm Lara Agnoli. As you can understand by my accent and by the way I will move my hands during the presentation, I'm not French, I'm Italian, okay? And we will talk a little bit about what are the big trends nowadays in the wine markets. You know, when talking about big trends, we cannot avoid to talk about what is happening nowadays. That has a huge impact, not only in the world of wine, but in the way we are living our life. So this is actually a picture that gives you an idea about forecasts of what is going to happen in the future according to market analysts, to the world of wine and wine sales. So we can see that actually forecasts say that it will be very likely that we will have a drop of sales of around 9.7%. Actually, this is not a so bad picture if we compare wine with the other alcoholic beverage. In fact, it is forecast that beer will have nearly a 10% of drop in sales, and spirits will even be more affected with a drop around 11%. Well, actually, as we can see through this picture, drops in wine consumption and decreasing in sales are basically due to Western Europe countries. Okay, so we can see that actually from 11.3 billion liters sold in Western Europe in 2019, forecast says that we will have a figure with around 10.3 billion liters sold. Actually, it's not a new news that consumption in these markets are dropping. We have seen a sort of stagnation of consumption in Western Europe, or in what is called to be actually in the wine world terms, the old world of wine, that started from the 80s. Actually, I was involved in a study analyzing consumption during the first lockdown in the four of the main producers in Western Europe. And what emerged is that actually consumers didn't decrease consumption, but decreased sales. So this means that actually they are rising their sellers, okay? Another part of the world that seems to be hit from the pandemic is Asia Pacific. Okay, so we can see that actually a part of the population that was increasing their consumption, especially in the last period after the COVID crisis, is living a negative phase. Okay. What actually marketers and analysts forecast is that even in 5 years, the world of wine won't become again as we used to have it before the crisis. But this is very much typical also for the other markets. Okay. So what I want to tell you during this half an hour is give you, let's say, five keywords that can help the wine industry to survive the events. Where does these five keywords come from? Well, this is what actually most of market analysts analyzed as positive points from which the wine world can work in order to better develop their activities after this big crisis we are living. Okay, so what I'm going to give you are some food for thoughts in order to try to understand what is going on and what can be positive leverages on which the wine industry can work on in order to avoid the disaster, okay? So the first keyword we can analyze in order to understand one positive aspect the wine industry can leverage on is health, okay? Actually, if we talk about wine and health, this has always been a quite challenging case, okay? From one side, we have to do with wine that is an alcoholic beverage, okay? So it's an alcoholic beverage, and as actually marketers define it, it belongs together with caffeine and nicotine to what is called to be a recreational drug, okay? A recreational drug, this means that actually is one of the most consumed drugs in the world, if we consider wine under this perspective. From the other side, we have to do with a beverage that actually it's linked, if consumed, of course, with moderation, with positive effects. First of all, positive effects that are linked to the cardiovascular system of individuals, okay? And actually, the consumption of red wine has been proved to be beneficial from health. And also, many countries push on the consumption of red wine in order to actually try to avoid the consumption of massive other more alcoholic beverages. One example of big boom that red wine market, the red wine consumption had, for example, in the US, was due basically to what is called to be the French paradox. So during the 90s, what happened is that a famous TV show called 60 Minutes talked about this paradox in terms that even if French population used to consume more saturated fat than US consumers, it had been proved to be a subject to less problems, cardiovascular problems, than US population. And some researchers actually linked this fact to the consumption of red wine, okay? So from this TV show, the consumption of red wine in the US started to boom. This is the same that happened in China. In China, there was a famous speech from the Prime Minister Li Peng in 1997 that in order to avoid Chinese people to massively consume high in alcoholic beverages, promoted the consumption of red wine. And this is one of the reasons why red wine is so much consumed in China, much more than what wine is, okay? So linkage between health and wine is something that the industry should promote. But in fact, if we think about what is going on with governments and the fact that governments tend to protect consumers, what is happening is that actually some states impose also to wine as an alcoholic beverage to include in wine labels what is called to be health warnings. So some logos that warn people about the negative consequences of wine and alcoholic beverages on health. Actually, I was involved in a study trying to understand a little bit more the topic from a consumer perspective. So what we did was to analyze the effect of health warnings on attached to bottles of wine on consumers. And actually we analyzed consumer behavior into a main wine consumption markets. France, where actually is mandatory to have some kinds of health warnings on wine label, and Italy, where this is not mandatory. And what interesting emerged is that actually most of our sample wasn't able to recall any warning from an alcoholic beverage. And just 40% for France and 30% for Italy actually were able to correctly recall a kind of warning from a bottle of alcoholic beverage. What was also interesting to highlight was that for 72% of our sample, our French sample, these warnings had no effect at all, okay? Talking about Italy, 40%, nearly 40% of our respondents said that it had no effect, but what is important to notice is that for 38% of them, these make them think about the side effects of consumption. So we have to do with government trying to protect the health of people through the fact that they enter these logos on that battle, but from the other side, we have to do with most of consumers that cannot recall any of them, or for the French population, these kind of logos don't have any effect. When talking about wine and health, it's important to point out the attention on a big trend nowadays among producers, and a big trend that is strongly driven by a segment of consumer that is more and more attentive to health. I'm talking about low alcohol wine or no alcohol wine. We have to do with an increasingly important trend in the market that it's particularly important in Anglo-Saxon countries and in Russia and Japan, and more and more important in countries that traditionally are not associated to wine consumption for religion matters. It's a big trend, for example, in Saudi Arabia. Actually, Saudi Arabia is the ninth most important country nowadays in the consumption of low alcohol wine. So, first keyword to consider to survive the events is health. Second keywords, of course, is digital. We cannot talk about the world of wine today without talking about the digital connotation it is assuming. Okay, actually, digital connotation that have many different facets. First of all, we have to do with consumers that are spending more and more time on the net. Okay, and this is actually an opportunity to take both in order to fulfill the need actually that is not fulfilled at the moment, that is the need of socialization of people that try to fulfill through the consumption of wine. So basically people start to drink online nowadays to fulfill their need of socialization. And actually through the study I conducted in the European Union countries and lockdown, during the first lockdown, what emerged is that more and more people are involved in aperitifs through Zoom, for example. So given that we cannot meet anymore, there's a big trend of meeting online just to drink with friends. But there's a second important implications from this point of view. So the second important implication is that people start to drink online also to improve their knowledge. Okay, so more and more wineries are organizing online wine tastings. So actually to make their wine knowledgeable for consumers, but also to try to create a new experience that they used to produce through wine tourism, which is not able to be produced anymore. Okay.
Lara, I have a question. It's really like interesting that you said that wine tasting can be organized even online. Did you
yes.
have any kind of experience with that, how that works? And maybe some of our participants had a similar experience. They are all in wine market. So maybe you can tell us more about it.
Yes, sure. So what happened is that there's a winery that organizes a tasting for a group of people. They deliver the wine at home. They have a meeting through Zoom or to any other platform. And they explain the wine. They also produce some videos to better introduce people into the virtual reality of what a visit of the winery will be. And so you are provided with a kind of full experience. And instead of going personally and visiting the winery, they provide you with all the material that you need.
Okay. Well, that's a good solution in these times. So yes. Thank you for your
experience. Yes, sure. And actually, I conducted some research on this, and it seems that if we consider drinking online just for socialization is something that is very likely to disappear when this pandemic situation will be solved. Wine tastings online for knowledge or for an experience purpose are very likely to continue also after this pandemic, okay? So I think that this is a good leverage that a winery can point on, even because, I mean, maybe I don't have time to go and visit a winery in China, I don't have the money to do this trip, but this is another way to discover Chinese wines.
Yeah, well, let's keep the good practices from this period of
pandemic. Exactly. Exactly.
Thank you. Continue, please.
Okay. So this is one aspect to take into account when we think about the digital. Another important aspect that is strongly pushed by this pandemic is buying wine online. And in this, from this point of view, China is at the forefront in this aspect. We have to think that 29% of wine sold off trade in China is sold online. They have an extremely efficient system to quickly deliver wine at home. This means that you are buying your wine and you can get your wine bottles at home after 4 hours. This is amazing. And that's why people are so used to buy wine online, even because sometimes the price of wine they buy online is even lower than going in a shop and buy the bottle. And also because it's more convenient. They deliver you the 6 bottles of wine and you don't have to carry it from the supermarket. As you can see, in 10 years, this trend in China has exploded. The same didn't happen in the other markets in the world, but we can see that in 10 years, this trend has evolved a lot. And we cannot talk about digital without mentioning important aspect linked to the communication of wine.
And maybe another question that is, I think, important, it's related to this online ordering wine.
Yes.
So do people order directly from wineries, or they have a different system of ordering?
Well, in China especially, there are some big platforms like Alibaba or common platforms from where people buy everything. Also WeChat is a lot, much used to order wine online. And it's very much organized in this sense. So it's
other countries, they cannot, I mean, order from AliExpress, I guess. Do they order from directly wineries? And is it a good thing from wine owners, maybe winery owners, to think in this direction, to maybe offer this delivery more fast, more, efficient to the consumers?
Well, actually, also in other countries, these kind of platforms, particularly devoted to wine, are developing. Mm-hmm. An example, actually, of platforms that is used as an app for a mobile phone, basically to understand better wine from the consumer point of view, can be used to order wine online. Yes, this is an opportunity that the single winery can work on by themselves to deliver wine to the final consumer. But it's not so easy, especially for small wineries, to organize a system able to be so efficient to deliver wine at home to consumers. Okay, so big wineries are more effective in offering wine directly bought through the e-commerce. Smaller wineries are more attached to these platforms that are better in organizing logistics and all the other aspects linked to shipping wine to the final consumer.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. So, e-commerce, it's strongly linked to the digital experience, but we cannot avoid also to talk about influencers, about applications, and about social media. So these are all aspects that are devoted to provide consumers with knowledge about the product they want to buy, and to give information about price, about the world of wine in general also. Actually, a kind of information that when we consider wine influencers comes from some people that are supposed to know more than the average consumer. But more and more, what people look at are also the opinion of peers. So, for example, if we look at Vivino, there's a part of Vivino that is devoted to give your own judge about the wine. And this is a part that is taken more and more into account by people in order to get informed about the wine that they want to buy. Okay, so digital, I will identify this term as the second keyword, not in order of importance, in order to try to survive the crisis. Third keyword, I will say that is terroir. Not because I'm based in Burgundy, but because it's extremely important for people to have to do with a wine that comes from somewhere rather than a wine that comes from everywhere. So we talk about terroir, but we don't just limit the definition of terroir to the strict viticultural definition just linked to the soil. Terroir is everything that turns around the wine production. So we talk about the savoir-faire, we talk about the know-how that is developed in the area of production, we talk about producer and the history of producer and the history of production area. If we talk about terroir, we cannot avoid to talk about French wines, okay? French wines, but also Italian wines, are strongly linked to this definition of wine. A wine that comes from a particular space, okay? And actually the European Union protects this definition of terroir through the denomination of origin. So the denomination of origin can be considered like a kind of legal identification of the term of terroir. But don't think that this is just linked to wines that come from Europe. Also countries from the New World of Wine, so I'm talking about US, I'm talking about, for example, Australia, are developing their offering in order to meet this particular consumer need. I'm talking about, for example, the AVA wines in the US. So they are also developing this kind of denomination, American viticultural area, through which they develop particular wines that come from this particular place. We talk about, for example, regional brands in Australia. So also New Worlds of Wine are promoting this kind of offers in order to meet consumer needs. Actually, one of the main effects of the pandemic when we consider wine consumption is the increasing attention of consumers towards what is locally produced, okay? And actually this helps terroir wines into their growth throughout this difficult period. And actually this fact, the link to the local, mostly because this is perceived as something that is safer, but is also perceived as something that can actually be good for the local producer. So it can be good also to support the local society in these difficult times. And actually this aspect of terroir is particularly linked to the fourth keywords that I'm explaining you today to try to face the crisis. That is sustainability. We cannot talk about trends not including sustainability. This is a huge trend in the wine market as well as in all the other markets nowadays. Okay, so sustainability, and this is also reflected in the fact that actually organic wines are living a very positive phase nowadays and in the last years. So there's an increasing segment of consumer that is more and more attentive to everything that is sustainable, that it's cultivated without pesticides, that follows particular production processes. And this is actually also clear in this graph. We can see that actually if conventional wine has a decrease in the years of 0.6% from a volume growth term, we can see that the inverse trend is leaving the organic wine, because we have to do with an increase of around 8%, okay? So we talk about sustainability, but when we talk about sustainability, it's not enough to talk about organic wines. When we talk about sustainability and wine, there are a lot of different brands that we can find attached into a bottle of wine. So yes, we have to do with organic wine with many different brands considering different production countries. We can have to do with a biodynamic wine, okay, following a more strict production processes with lunar phases and following a particular production methods. We can also talk about in general sustainable wine. So people used to think about sustainable wine just taking into account the environmental aspect. But actually when we talk about sustainability, we also have to take into account the social and the economic aspects, okay? So sustainable wines are wines that help not just the environment, but also the local society and the economic production of the society. We talk about natural wines with other brands attached to the labels. We can also talk about carbon zero wine. So labels that are attached into bottles of wine in order to testify the efforts of producers to reduce carbon emissions. We also talk about vegan wines. It may seem obvious that a wine is vegan, but it's not the case. Because, for example, fish glues are used to attach the label to the bottle, or white egg is used for some processes, for example, of clarifications of white wines. So vegan wine brands testify that everything you can find in the bottle nothing comes from any animal production. What is the effect of all these brands in the market? In most cases, the consumer is completely unaware about what is the difference between one and the other, is particularly confused when he faces all these different brands in a bottle of wine. So what is going to happen, and the proposal of different countries in the world in order to make it clearer for consumers what is the level of sustainability of the bottle produced or all the other products produced, and they propose these traffic light variant to all these brands in order to indicate the level of sustainability of a wine. We will see in the following months what is going to happen, if actually this proposal will be approved or not. Let's finish with the last keywords, not because it's the least important, but because I cannot avoid to give an order in this case, that is evolving tradition, okay? What does evolving tradition mean? Since 20 years ago, we had to do with a segment, the most important segment of wine consumers that were the baby boomer, okay? Actually, also nowadays, baby boomers are important in terms of quantity consumed of wine. But we have to do with a segment that actually nowadays, it implies 31% of the world population. That is the segment of millennial. Millennial is a completely, the millennial segment, so this means people born between 1978 and 2000, even if in literature the definition of the age class is not so clear. So young people that have a completely different way to conceive wine than the previous generations, okay? So they support quality of production, quality of wine that they consume, instead of pointing out on quantities, okay? So this is the segment that is more involved in premium wine consumption. This is the segment that used wine as a means to socialize. This is a segment that is also more prone to support innovations, innovations that for millennials must be green and must be healthy, okay? So this is the segment that is not more linked, especially in the old world of wine, to a consumption situation that it's linked to everyday meals. So, but they are trying to renew the world of wine also in traditionally consuming and producing countries. So wine is consumed with friends, is consumed during dinner with friends, is consumed to socialize. Wine is not a way to transgress as the other alcoholic beverage used to be. Wine is still a product that keeps a kind of posh image, especially if we talk about countries like China, okay? Wine actually becomes a kind of status symbol. Okay, it's very posh to order a glass of wine instead of a pint of beer. Okay, wine is something that is very likely to be mixed with other alcoholics. You know, I'm from Veneto, And spritz used to be very popular in Veneto also 20 years ago. Nowadays, spritz is exported more and more abroad. I conducted a study on this, and actually, young people in some cases are even not aware that in spritz, inside the spritz beverage, you find wine. Actually, nowadays, Prosecco is promoting spritz very much. So things are changing. But 10 years ago, when I conducted this study, young people were even not aware that wine was inside the spritz. Okay, so this is a particularly interesting and important generation for wine consumption. And this was the last keywords. So thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any question, I'm here to answer.
Yes, if you have any questions, you can write down in our chat box or Q&A. So Lara, thank you very much for this insight about trends in wine. Can you tell us maybe in a couple of sentences something about Burgundy School of Business? You're from Italy, from
yes.
The other region. So you moved to France to teach about wines. And can you tell us something regarding that?
Yes, sure. Actually, I started to work here in Dijon in 2016. I'm a professor of wine marketing. And we actually have two masters, one MBA and one master completely devoted to wine and spirits. We have one MBA in wine and spirits business, and this is devoted to people that already have an experience in the world of wine, or at least people that already have an experience in the working environment. So it's devoted to people, let's say, around 30s. And then we have a master that it's more devoted to younger people that have just finished the university and they want to deepen this world. And this is a master of science in wine management. So we have a full experience in the world of wine from the marketing point of view, but also from the production point of view. We also organize inside our school classes to reach the WSET2 level. This is including both masters, and there's also the possibility to go on and participate to WSET3. WSET level 3 classes.
Well, I heard definitely that Burgundy as a region is the right place to learn more about wine. But on your MBA program offered by BSB, I know that you have 4 study visits to different regions.
Yes.
To learn more about different like production, ways of production or distribution of wine or marketing. So maybe you can tell us more about it.
Yes.
But I think it's really important from those who are already in the wine business, because
yes,
we have those kind of inquiries from the wine wineries owners. They want to know what will they actually have as a value after maybe having MBA program at your school.
Yes, sure. Actually, a lot of visit experiences are offered to MBA students. Usually, we organize a field trip to Provine in Germany, Chia. We organize another field trip in Gassenheim to develop a digitalization module. We organize a field trip in London to meet distributors in the market. You know, London is a very international market and it's an important market when we consider wine consumption and distribution. The same is organized in New York. There's a field trip of 1 week organized in New York where a student usually meet distributor, retailers, and where they try to understand a little bit more the wine perspective from a new world of wine, you know. And also some visits are organized to better discover French wines. So normally there are also a couple of field trips, one of course in Burgundy, but you know, living here is quite easy.
Yes.
When the situation will be better to go and visit, I mean, wineries are everywhere. And usually there's also the possibility to also visit another wine region in France. So it's quite rich in terms of experiences, not just focusing in Burgundy, but also in other very important markets from a wine perspective.
And also for those who are into spirit business making.
Yes, okay. Sure. Actually, all the modules you will have to deal with will have both a wine and a spirit focus. Okay, of course, these words are strictly connected. You know, I talk better about wine because I have a PhD in wine economics, so it's easier for me. But of course, when I teach, I also take spirits into account, and this is an important part of our modules.
Okay, so and for the end of our session, I really encourage all of you to contact Professor Agnoli regarding anything you want to know more about the study program. But a tricky question is basically, do you prefer Italian or French wines? You knew that I'm going to ask this.
Did I give my official answer? No, no. Or my real answer?
No, I'm just curious because I was actually surprised to see that actually Portugal is number one by wine consuming, well, France yes, the second place, and I expected Italy to be, you know, somewhere there. The third or something like that, but having known that you're Italian, definitely I had to, you know, ask this question. Official.
Well, I'm born in the art of Valpolicella, so I cannot say that something different than Valpolicella, but you know, it's different when you work in the world of wine to identify just one wine that it's your preferred wine in the world, but I'm still attached to my roots, so.
Okay, fair answer. Okay, Lara, thank you a lot for your time, for this lovely masterclass. I hope to have more of these sessions together because we have really rising market here in the Balkans regarding wine business. There are many wineries opening, and I think that there should be more people interested how they can, you know, widen their business, improve their wine quality, and maybe even enroll to a program at BSB finally. Thank you once again, and hope to see you in Dijon then.
Yes, sure. Okay, thank you very much. And if you need, we are here.
Okay, thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.